أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. كدأب آل فرعون والذين من قبلهم كفروا بآيات الله فأخذهم الله بذنوبهم إن الله قوي شديد العقاب. ذلك بأن الله لم يك مغيرا نعمة أنعمها على قوم حتى يغيروا ما بأنفسهم وأن الله سميع عليم. صدق الله العظيم. In all the Madani surahs that we have already studied, Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Imran, Surah Al-Nisa, Surah Al-Ma'idah, there were addresses to the Muslims, then references and address to the Munafiqeen, and then the Bani Israel, the Jews, the people of the book. So here in this surah also, now there is a reference to the Jews. كداب آل فرعون والذين من قبلهم, like the manner of people of Fir'aun and those before him. كفروا بآيات الله, they disbelieved the revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فأخذهم الله بذنوبهم, so Allah seized them due to their misdeeds and sins. إن الله قوي شديد العقاب, verily, certainly, Allah is قوي, all powerful, almighty, and he is very severe in punishment. Now this one ayah refers to all the stories of the messengers of Allah that appeared in Surah Al-A'raf. But making more apparent reference towards Ali Fir'aun. But actually, the people of Nuh, the people of Hud, the people of Saleh, the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, to whom Hazrat Lut was sent, then people of Shu'aib, and then Ali Fir'aun. But because this Ali Fir'aun, really, they had special relationship with the Jews, because the Jews were persecuted by them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delivered and saved them from their persecution. So actually now, he has been singled out, Fir'aun and his people. Kadabi Ali Fir'aun. But it actually refers to all the nations who were destroyed because they didn't accept the da'wah of the messengers of Allah who were sent to them. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَكُنْ مُغَيِّرًا نِعْمَةً أَنْعَمَهَا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ. This is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't change the favor with which he has blessed any nation. حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ, unless they change what is in their souls. This is a very permanent law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sunnatullah. And we shall read it because, you know, Surah Al-Ra'd and Surah Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam, in these two surahs, this subject will be discussed in detail. La yughayyiru ma biqawmin hatta yughayyiru ma bi'anfusihim. Whatever is in your souls, you have to change it. If you don't change what is within your souls, the condition will not change. And this is the biggest blunder that all the Muslim movements of today, the so-called jihadi movements, they are missing the point here. Before purifying the souls of the people, they want that the system should be changed. How can the system be changed? The inner personalities of the people should be changed first. Their thinking should change. Their value structure should change. What did Muhammad do? I am going to discuss it tomorrow in detail. What was the process for revolution? How he revolutionized the whole society and the whole country, rather the whole peninsula of Arabia. He changed the souls of the people first, their thinking, their structure, their beliefs, their value structure, everything was changed. So you have to change people from within. As I quoted many a times, a couplet from Allama Iqbal, that this Quran, when it penetrates the inner soul of a person, he is changed from within. And when the inner personality of a person changes, first of all, the whole world changes for him, because now his point of view has changed. And then this is the beginning of a revolution. So this is very important. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَكُرُ مُغَيِّرَ النِّعْمَةَ الْأَنْعَمَهَا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Allah is all-hearing, all-knowing. كَذَابِ عَلِ فِرَوْنَ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. Again a reference to the whole history of the messengers of Allah and their nations who were doomed. كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ. They rejected, denied the revelations of their Lord as well as the miracles that were shown to them. Ayat, you know, it covers both the things. Because the teachings of the prophets, they are also ayat of Allah, revelations, ayatul Quran. These are ayat. But also, you know, the miracles that were given to Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, nine of them. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَىٰ تِسْعَ آيَاتٍ بَيِّنَاتٍ. Nine clear signs were given to, and we have read them in Surah Al-Araf. كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ فَأَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ. We destroyed them. بِذُنُوبِهِمْ, due to their sins and misdeeds. وَأَغْرَقْنَا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَكُلٌّ كَانُوا ظَالِمِينَ. And we drowned the people of Fir'aun, and they were the evil doers, the transgressors. إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Verily, the worst of the beasts on earth, animals on earth, are those humans who make kufr. What is kufr? I discussed it. You know, this testimony of that Allah is here, Allah is our Lord, this testimony is in our souls. Our souls testify to it. We had that firm covenant with him. أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ. We have read it in Surah Al-A'raf. So that, you know, testimony, our souls has it in it, but we suppress it. Why? Due to our vested interests, due to our positions. We are the leaders. So they suppressed. Kufr means to hide something, kufr. To do away with something, to reject something. All these are the meanings of this word kufr. إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Because they have already suppressed the testimony of their nature within themselves, they are not going to believe. Whatever you do, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or whatever you do, O Muslims, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. الَّذِينَ أَحَدْتَ مِنْهُمْ. Now, the clear reference to the Jews. Because the Prophet, when he came over to Medina, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was a masterpiece of his, you know, statesmanship. If you read the book written by Montgomery Watt, Muhammad at Medina, he wrote the biography of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in two volumes, Muhammad at Makkah, Muhammad at Medina. Although there was a trick, a very subtle, you know, trick in it, but I don't want to go into that detail. But, you know, he uses all the words of praise in English language in superlative form for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His statesmanship, his farsight, his understanding of the situation. And one of the things that he cites is that he immediately on reaching Medina, he concluded treaties with all the three tribes of Jews who were living round about Medina. He, you know, just had them in the fold of that Misaq Medina. And a joint defense treaty was concluded with them. This is very important. But what happened? These people, they concluded the treaty, but secretly they were violating it. They were sending messages to Quraysh, come, or you invade, and we shall help from within. So they were doing it. Now this is the reference to this character of theirs. Alladina ahatta minhum, those of them with whom you had a treaty, ahad. Summa yanquduna ahdahum, and they are breaking their treaty, their covenant, fi kulli marratin, every time. whenever there is time of mischief, they don't, you know, keep their words, go back on their words. وَهُمْ لَا يَتَّقُونَ, and they have no fear of Allah, and they don't care for anything. فَإِمَّا تَسْقَفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْحَرْبِ. So if you find them, and if you encounter them in the battlefield, فَشَرِّدْ بِهِمْ مَنْ خَلْفَهُمْ, so disperse through them those who are behind them. Give them the worst punishment, so that people who are behind, who are sitting back in Medina, who are pulling the ropes, they get terrified, you know. So that is the philosophy of punishments in Islam also. The punishments in Islam, exemplary. Why? Cut off the hand, so that now theft will be eliminated from the society. In the same way, all these punishments, you know, they seem to be very, you know, for to others they call it, they are very cruel, very harsh. But actually, crime cannot be eradicated. Now it is proved. There can be no higher level of education than the level you have in America. But has this education and all this, you know, has it eradicated crime from your society? Most heinous crime is there. You can't reform the society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed. In the same way, to those enemies of Allah, whomsoever you find in the battlefield, give him the severest punishment, so that it terrifies those who are sitting behind in Medina, and you know, they also get the message through them. فَإِمَّا تَسْقَفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْحَرْبِ فَشَرِّدْ بِهِمْ مَنْ خَلْفَهُمْ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ, so that they may be admonished, and they think twice before taking any step against you. وَإِمَّا تَخَافَنَّ مِنْ قَوْمٍ خَيَانَةً. This is also very important. Every ayah of Quran is important. Someone from some one aspect, the other from some other aspect, but every word of Allah is most important. إِمَّا تَخَافَنَّ مِنْ قَوْمٍ خِيَانَةً. If you fear a treachery from any group with whom you have a treaty, well, you are faithful, you are fulfilling all the conditions of your side, of the treaty, but you feel that the other party is treacherous, is not keeping its terms of treaty. فَمْبِزْ إِلَيْهِمْ عَلَىٰ سَوَىٰ. So throw back to them their treaty on equity basis. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْخَائِنِينَ. Verily Allah doesn't like the treacherous ones. Now what's the message in this ayah? If you keep the treaty intact and take any step against that group or nation or tribe, this is treacherous. If you want and you decide that you have to take some action against them, first of all, declare that no treaty between you and us now. This is the character of the Muslims. Not treachery. Having a treaty legally and under the table fighting each other. This behoves of non-Muslims but not of Muslims. Whenever you have a treaty and you feel that the other party is not keeping the treaty, but also not declaring that the treaty is finished, but you, before taking any step against them, you must declare that now this treaty stands annulled. Then you take the step. وَلَا يَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَبَقُوا أَنَّهُمْ لَا يُعْجِزُونَ. And these people who have rejected the faith, because the Jews rejected the faith, although they knew Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the Prophet of Allah, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاهُمْ. We have read it so many times. So they reject it knowingly. لَا يَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَبَقُوا. They don't think they will escape. إِنَّهُمْ لَا يُعْجِزُونَ. They are not going to overcome or outwit or outdo Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَقْرُ اللَّهُ, you know, they can't keep them safe from that. وَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَسْتَطَعَتُمْ. And O believers, keep ready with you. عَيْدُّوا لَهُمْ. Prepare against them. مَسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ. All the force that you can gather, which is in your power. Now this appears to be somewhat contradictory. You have faith in Allah. So Allah will look after everything. Allah will take care of you. No. You have to do whatever you can. You don't leave any stone unturned. You have to do whatever you can do. Then have faith in Allah. There is a very beautiful incident of the life of the Prophet ﷺ. A Bedouin came to see him. And you know, he didn't tie the knee of the she camel he was riding, just left her as free and stepped into the mosque to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he asked, why didn't you tie the leg, the knee of the she camel? He said, I have faith in Allah. I have trust in Allah. The Prophet said, no, go back. Aqilha, summa tawakkal. Go and tie the knee and then have faith in Allah and confidence in Allah. Whatever you can do, you have to do. But don't think that you can do anything only through your own power or your own, you know, endeavors. Blessings of Allah are required. Finally, everything rests with Him. His decision, you know, that will be implemented. وَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَبِرِبَاطِ الْخَيْلِ. And also the steeds of war. Today, you know, the tanks you should have, the all the things, you know, everything you must have with you, as much as you can. And here let me mention, the atomic capability is a very big blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Pakistan. And these people are very fearful, lest we can prepare and we explode an atomic bomb. Although they have it, they say, this is an exclusive right of ours, we can have it. We are mature enough, you know, we won't misuse it. But you are not dependable people, you may misuse it. So that is actually, we are not grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we shall be brought to the book. We gave you this capability, and this capability came to Pakistan miraculously. We couldn't get it. It was from Allah's grace that we got it. But you know, all the pressure on that country, that you stop it, you cap it, you know, take it, roll it back, and so on, it's going on. But Allah's command is different. Whatever you can do, you must prepare and you must keep ready. وَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَمِنْ رِبَاطِ الْخَيْرِ تُرْهِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوَّ اللَّهِ. So that you terrorize with this thing, the enemies of Allah, وَعَدُوَّكُمْ, and your enemies. Your enemies are Allah's enemies. Allah's enemies are your enemies. You are with Allah. Allah is with you. وَآخَرِينَ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَهُمْ اللَّهُ يَعْلَمُهُمْ. And there are others beside them whom you don't know, Allah knows. You have a fifth columnist, you know, people here in your society. When they will see that Muslims are very ready, then they will also be terrorized and they won't be able to take any courage against you, to show any courage and take any action against you. So you have to remain prepared and gather whatever force of whatever kind is possible you must have at your disposal. وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ شَيْنًا. Because for this preparation you need money, you need funds, you need finances. For that the encouragement. وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ شَيْنًا فَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ يُوَفَّيْ لَيْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تُسْلَمُونَ. Whatever you will spend in the way of Allah to procure all these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you fully, reward you fully. يُوَفَّيْ لَيْكُمْ. It will be repaid you in full. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تُسْلَمُونَ. And you will not be wronged. وَإِنْ جَنَهُوا لِلسَّلْمِ فَنْجَحْ لَهَا. And if these people, if they incline to peace, فَنْجَحْ لَهَا, you also incline. Because if they want a peace, okay, have peace with them. And have a treaty with them. وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. And then you have faith in Allah. That if they are making this treaty dishonestly, they want to do something else, Allah will take care of them. But if you feel that they are going to do something wrong, then first of all, you throw the treaty on their faces, and then only you can take this step. Your moral level must be much higher than their moral level. It should be visible to the people. What's the moral level of the Muslims, and what's the moral level of the Jews, and the Mushrikeen of Makkah. وَإِنْ يُرِيدُوا يَخْدَعُوكَ. The same thing which I have already said. If they intend to deceive you, فَإِنْ حَسْبَكَ اللَّهُ. So then Allah is sufficient for you. He will take care of them all. هُوَ الَّذِي أَيَّدَكَ بِنَصْرِهِ وَبِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It is He, جَلَّ جَلَالُهُ وَعَمَّ نَوَالُهُ. It is He who has strengthened you with His own help and with the Muslims. He has provided you these companions. He has provided you these volunteers who are ready to sacrifice everything, who are ready to lay down their lives. who cherish death in the way of Allah. Shahadat hai matloob o maqsood e momin, namaz e ghanimat na kishwar kushai. Whom have you had given you these people? Allah has given you. So Allah helps you directly, and this is Allah's help which has come to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, through these companions, these fellows, your helpers. Because what happened to Moses, we have read in Surah Al-Maida. When he called upon his people, now go and fight for the cause of Allah, they said, clearly replied, no, we are not going to move. فَقَبَلْتَ وَرَبُّكَ فَقَاتِلَا إِنَّا هَاوْنَا قَاعِدُونَ. We are sitting here. You go and take your Lord with you, and take your staff also with you, and go and drive them out from this country, and then we shall only enter this country. But Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the companions who were ready to lay down their lives. وَإِن يُرِيدُوا وَيَخْدَعُوكَ فَإِنَّ حَزْبَكَ اللَّهِ هُوَ الَّذِي أَيَّدَكَ بِنَسْرِهِ وَبِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَعَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ. And another special favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done on you, He has brought the hearts of your companions together, united them. They are more than real brothers. وَلَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ. Had you spent all the wealth that is in this world, you could not have united their hearts. Iman has united them. Bunyanu marsus. Now they are like a reinforced structure. No breach, no dispute. No money could have brought about that type of unity which Iman has brought. لَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ أَلَّفَ بَيْنَهُمْ. It is Allah who has united their hearts. إِنَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. Verily, He is all-powerful and He is all-wise. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ حَسْبُكَ اللَّهُ وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. O Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, for you Allah is sufficient, and for those also who are following you. Now this ayah can be translated in two ways. Allah is sufficient for you also and for your followers also. And Allah and your followers are sufficient for you. The second meaning is more, you know, according to the text. Because we found in the former ayah, هُوَ الَّذِي أَيَّدَكَ بَجَسْرِهِ وَبِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthened you with His own help and with these mu'mins, with these people. So in the same way, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ حَسْبُكَ اللَّهُ وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. For you, Allah and these believers who are following you, they are sufficient. Don't fear anything. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ حَرِّضِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عَلَى الْقِتَالِ. O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, exhort the believers to go to war in the cause of Allah, in the way of Allah. In yakum minkum ishuna sabirun, if there will be from amongst you 20 persevering Muslims, yaglibu mi'atain, they will overpower 200. 1 to 10. Vain yakum minkum mi'atun, and if there will be 100, yaglibu alfan, they will be victorious over 1,000. مِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, from among those who have rejected the faith and who have suppressed the testimony of their own souls also. بِأَنَّهُ الْقَوْمُ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ, because they are the people, they don't understand. The understanding of the realities of this universe enhances your power. When you know everything is in the hand of Allah, nobody can harm me anything. Now your courage, you know. And a person again, he thinking he can do me something. He can harm me. He can bring some bad thing to me. Well, he will be fearing anybody, everybody. He will be always fearing. And the person who knows, nobody can do any harm to me. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. لا أصاب من مصيبة إلا بإذن الله. Nothing, no harm can come to me. They might try their best. They can't do me any harm. Now your courage, your fearlessness, this cannot be measured. So because they don't know it, this is the truth that they don't know. That nothing can be done without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا. In the next surah we shall read it. قل لن يصيبنا الا ما كتب الله لنا هو مولانا. Nothing can happen to us except that with Allah, He has decided for us. And He is our protector, He is our friend. Whatever comes from Him, it's always welcome. Even if it is death, it's okay. It's actually the gateway to heaven, the gateway to Jannah. قِيلَ ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِي يَعْلَمُونَ بِمَا غَفَرَ لِي رَبِّي وَجَعَلَنِي مِنَ الْمُكْرَمِينَ. No sooner you are dead here in the way of Allah and you enter directly to the heaven. You don't have to wait for the day of judgment. These shuhada who lay down their lives in the way of Allah, they go direct. They will not be waiting for the day of judgment to come. They go direct. So how now, what thing can you know, can terrorize a Muslim or a mu'min who is a true believer? Ya ayyuhan nabiy yuhammid al mu'minina al qital in yakum minkum 20 sabiruna yaghlibu 200 wa in yakum minkum 100 yaghlibu 1000 min alladhina kafaru bi annahum qawmun la yafqahun. Al-ana khaffafa Allahu ankum. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has lightened it for you. Wa'alima anna fikum dha'fa. And He knows that now a weakness has started within you. Why? You know, in the early days of the Madani period, there were no munafiqeen. But now, as time passed, this element started growing. So that was a sort of weakness. Because, you know, after all, they were legal Muslims. They were included as Muslims. I told you many a time that nowhere in the Quran the munafiqeen had been addressed as Ya ayyuhal ladhina nafaqoo. Ya ayyuhal munafiqoon, you don't find these words. Because they were also legal Muslims. Whenever something is said to the munafiqeen, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, these are the words. Because they also profess to believe. So actually, secondly, you know, the depth of commitment of those people who came from Makkah, who had undergone all the hardships, who had passed so many examinations and tests and trials and tribulations, you know, the depth of conviction with them, it is unimaginable. But the Ansar of Medina, because they had not passed through such tests and trials and tribulations, so that was not the case. They were not equal to the Muhajirin. So now, as time passes, you know, taken collectively, the whole community, the average would go down. Although, you know, As-Sabiqun al-Awwalun, they remain at that level. They don't go down. But you know, taken the community as a whole, the average will come down. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-ana khaffafa Allahu ankum wa'alima anna fikum da'fa. He knows that there is a weakness among you. وَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ مَيَتُونْ صَابِرَتُونْ يَغْلِبُ مَيَتَيْنْ. If you are from you, there are 100 who are persevering, they will overcome 200. وَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أَلْفٌ يَغْلِبُ أَلْفَيْنْ. And if from you there are 1,000, they will overcome 2,000. بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. And Allah is with the preserving people who are persevering and who are steadfast. مَا قَالَ لِنَبِيٍ أَن يَكُونَ لَهُ أَسْرَى. Now this is a very sensitive issue which is being discussed here. You know, after the Muslims had won the Battle of Badr, I told you 70 mushrikeen were killed. From among the Muslims only 14, 13 on the spot. And one was injured, and he died on way back to Medina. The total toll from Muslim side was 14. The Kuffar, of Quraysh, 70. Another 70 were taken prisoners, captives. Now this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so to say, using the most, you know, lenient words, He was displeased with it. Why did you do it? You shouldn't have taken them captives. Because the power of kufr has not been, you know, broken up till now. If you have taken them captives, they will pay some ransom money and they'll go back. When they go back, they will again be able to come to fight against you. So actually there was a dispute. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he consulted his companions, what we should do with them. his own inclination, because he was Rauf and Rahim. He was very lenient, very kind. To kill them, it was something, you know, against his nature. So he was inclined towards taking them captive and, you know, releasing them, taking some money and so on. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu agreed with him, yes, this we should do. But Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was very much against it. No. We should kill them all. So that, you know, this strength of kufr is initiated. It is broken. Their backs will be broken. And he went to the extent that whosoever is closest in relation to any mushrik captive from among the Muslims, he should assassinate with his own hands his closest relative who has come here, who came here to fight against the Muslims and who has been taken into captive. But you know, later on it was decided, no, we shall keep them as captives and we shall accept the ransom money and then we shall set them free. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is declaring his displeasure over this decision. And this is one of those events about which it is said, Al-haqq yantiqu ala lisani Umar. كان رأيه موافقا بالوحي والكتاب. Rather we should say, وحي came موافقا برأيه. كان الوحي موافقا برأيه. وحي came in agreement with his opinion. So this is the special station, place and, you know, cadre and level of Hazrat Umar رضي الله تعالى عنه. الحق ينطق على لسان عمر أشدهم في أمر الله عمر ما كان للنبي أن يكون له أسرى. It's not befitting for a prophet that there should be captives for him. حتى يسخن في الأرض. Until there is sound crushing and threshing of the kufr in the land. Turidun arad al-dunya. You intend to get the wealth of this world? Ransom money? That appears to be very attractive to you. Very harsh comments. It was actually not that the Prophet wanted some money or some wealth. It was out of mercy, out of leniency. That was the second nature of it. Twice in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has addressed him. Be harsh to these munafiqeen. Be harsh. You shouldn't be kind to these people. But because it was his nature, second nature as we call it. Ya ayyuha nabiyyu jahidil kuffara wal munafiqeena waghluz alayhim. You should not be lenient to these people. You should be harsh. You have to treat them with harshness. So that the back of kufr is broken. If you are lenient, they get, you know, some extension. They are fresh leaves of existence they are having due to your leniency. حَتَّى يُسْخَلَ فِي الْأَرْضِ تُرِيدُونَ عَرَضَ الدُّنْيَا وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةِ. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends akhirah for you. وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. And Allah is all-powerful, almighty and all-wise. لَوْلَا كِتَابٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ سَبَقَ. Had it not been for an ordinance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that had already gone before. And this refers to ayah number 4 of Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which you find in the 26th part of the Mus'haf. There it was given an option that whenever the strength of the kufr has been broken, then you can take captives. Now please ponder over it. Whether the back of kufr has been broken or not, it's a judgment. Maybe I think it has been broken. You think it has not been broken. If it has been broken according to my assessment, then we can have captives. If it is not broken up till now, according to your judgment, then you will say, no captives. Allah has not granted us to have captives before the back of the kufr has been broken thoroughly. So because this is the principle in ijtihad, al-mujtahid al-mukhti, he also is rewarded. He cannot be punished. المجتہد المصیب ہی گیٹس دی ڈبل ریوارڈ. سو اٹ واز ٹیکن ٹو بی این اجتہاد آف محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم اینڈ ابو بکر رضی اللہ عنہ دیٹ یو نو ایکچولی دی پاور آف کفر ہیز بین بروکن, سو ناؤ وی کین ٹیک دی کیپٹیوز. بٹ اللہ ڈس ایگریڈ ود دی اجتہاد, بٹ یو کانٹ پنش اینی بڈی آن اجتہاد وین اٹ واز دیئر سنسیئر اوپینئن. ویل اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ اونلی ڈکلیئرڈ ہز ڈس ایگریمنٹ ود اجتہاد. یو کین ڈفر فرام اے مجتہد ان ہز ججمنٹ, نو ڈاؤٹ, بٹ یو نو ان اجتہاد وچ ہیز بین ڈن موسٹ سنسیئرلی ارنسٹلی, یو نو ایون اف اٹ از رانگ, اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ ریوارڈز اٹ, ریوارڈز فار اٹ. سو دیٹ از دی کیس. لولا کتاب من اللہ سبقہ, دس آپشن ہیڈ بن گیون ٹو یو فرام اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ آلریڈی ان آیہ نمبر 4 سورۃ محمد. If that had not happened, لَمَسَّكُمْ فِيمَا أَخَذْتُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ, then what you have taken from them, on that a very mighty chastisement, a very mighty punishment would have come to you. Very stern warning. فَكُلُوا مِمَّا غَنِمْتُمْ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. So now you eat from whatever you have from the spoils of the war. Now what has been happened to the spoils of the war? The spoils, all the things that they had at the battle field. And now the spoils coming out of the ransom money of these captives. This is added to those spoils. فَكُلُوا مِمَّا غَنِمْتُمْ. Although Allah declared his disagreement with this decision, but because it was an ijtihad and the option was given by him, so now whatever you have got, you can eat it, you can use it, you can consume it. حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. It is permissible for you, it is good for you. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Have taqwa of Allah. And verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and merciful. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِمَنْ فِي أَيْدِيكُمْ مِنَ الْأَسْرَىٰ. O Prophet, say to these people who are in your hands from among the captives, إِنْ يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا. If Allah knows, and if Allah finds that within your hearts there is some good, يُوتِكُمْ خَيْرًا مِمَّا أُخِذَ مِنْكُمْ, He will give you better and more than what has been taken from you. Now please keep one point in mind. Some of the people of Quraysh who had come to fight against the Muslims at Badr, they were forced to do it because of the tribal system. They didn't want to go to war against the Muslims. There could be someone who had hidden in their hearts the iman, the faith also. But because they had not declared it there, had they declared it, they would have had to make the migration, the hijrah. So because they were not so much, you know, motivated by iman, that they were ready to leave their homes and hearts and, you know, the land of their ancestors, where the ancestors were lying buried. So that was not, the depth of conviction was not to that level. So they remained at Makkah. When they remained at Makkah, they had to come under the tribal system. Now because the tribe is going to fight against somebody, some enemy, you have to go. So there were certain people, you know. And according to some traditions, perhaps Hazrat Abbas, the uncle of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, was also among them. So, and there could be others also. So, now, if Allah knows that in your hearts there is something good, but because you have not up till now declared your iman, you came to fight the Muslims along with the kuffar, so law will take its course. You will be treated at par with other, the unbeliever captives, and you will have to pay the ransom. But Allah will reward you, Allah will repay you in His own ways. He will compensate. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِمَنْ فِي أَيْدِيكُمْ مِنَ الْأَسْرَىٰ إِنْ يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا مِمَّا أُخِذَ مِنْكُمْ. But his prayers are very vast. He can compensate to you in many other forms. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ, and he will forgive you. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, and Allah is forgiving, merciful. وَإِنْ يُرِيدُوا خِيَانَتَكَ, and if somebody now says that I am Muslim, I came only because I was forced to come here, so please forgive me and let me go scot-free. وَإِن يُرِيدُوا خِيَانَتَكَ فَقَدْ خَانُوا اللَّهَ مِنْ قَبْلُ. they have committed, you know, treachery with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also. If somebody is making treachery, he's treacherous in his behavior. فَأَمْكَنَ مِنْكُمْ. So Allah has given you power over them. Allahu alimul hakeem. And verily, He is all-knowing, all-wise. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آوَوا وَنَصَرُوا أُولَٰئِكَ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. Verily and certainly those who came to believe, وَهَاجَرُوا, and who migrated, وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and they strived in the way of Allah to their utmost, with their belongings and their lives. وَالَّذِينَ آوَوا وَنَصَرُوا, and those who gave them refuge and helped them. Now the Muslim society up till that time, you know, it was composed of two distinct parts at Medina. Muhajirin and the Ansar of Medina. And although Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had made them brothers, one from the Muhajirin, the other from Ansar, and they were declared as brothers. And you know, they divided their homes, they divided their shops. Even, you know, one Ansari, he took his Muhajir brother to his house. He had two wives. He said, you select which one you like, because, you know, the commandments about hijab, they have not been revealed up till now. They were going to be revealed several years later in Surah An-Nur and Surah Al-Ahzab. So there was no, you know, wheeling and no, all these things, you know, segregation, etc. It was a mixed society. So he took the brother to the home. I have two wives. You select, I will divorce her so that you can marry her. Because the Prophet has declared that you are my brother. And I can't, you know, bear that you live without a wife, and I have two wives with me. So that was the bond of friendship. But still, you know, these were the two distinctly separate sections of the society. And Quran is also mentioned separately. And here, you know, the level is different. Because those people who had migrated, left their families and homes and everything behind, you know, they were definitely at a very high level of the regarding the depth of commitment, regarding their love for Allah. Then, and actually, before the Battle of Badr, the 8 expeditions, which I shall explain, inshallah, next Friday evening when I go into details of Ghazwa Badr, the Prophet sent only the Muhajirin. In 8 expeditions. Badr was the first expedition in which Ansar were also included. They were never asked to go out to fight in the way of Allah. All the 8 expeditions, 4 of them Saraya, in which the Prophet didn't go himself, only some groups were sent. And 4 of them Ghazawat, in which the Prophet also participated. But in all 8 of them, nobody, no Ansari from Medina was included. So that is why these words are coming from the Muhajirs here. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Up till now only they were striving. And they were fighting for the cause of Allah, going out, you know, to meet the enemy. وَالَّذِينَ آوَوا وَنَصَرُوا. Now the second section is, who gave them the refuge? Who accommodated them in their homes and businesses, etc., etc. And they were the Ansar. They helped them. بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. Now they are friends to each other. They are protectors of each other. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَّمْ يُهَاجِرُوا مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ وَلَايَةٍ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. And as for those who had iman, who said the shahada, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, they became Muslim. But they didn't immigrate. They didn't come. We have read these things in much detail in Surah An-Nisa. This discussion, you know, this subject has been discussed. But Surah An-Nisa was going to be revealed several years later after this surah. This, as I told you, was revealed in the second year after Hijrah, just after the Battle of Badr. Surah An-Nisa, that was either in the 5th or the 6th year after Hijrah. So here is the first pronouncement regarding this. والذین آمنوا ولم یہاجروا ما لکم من ولایتہم من شیء. Those of you who come to believe, who accept the faith, but they don't immigrate to Medina, there is no, you are not responsible for their protection in anything until they immigrate. وَإِنْ اسْتَنْصَرُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ فَعَلَيْكُمُ النَّصْرُ. But if they ask for your help, it's incumbent upon you that you help them. But there is an exception. إِلَّا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ مِيثَاقٌ. Except against the nation or tribe with whom you have a treaty. For example, you know, there are some Muslims in some tribe. They are being persecuted. They call the Muslims to help. Now there are two conditions possible. If this tribe has no treaty with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the Muhammad has not concluded any treaty against this tribe, with this tribe, then you can take an action helping the Muslims of that tribe. But if you have a treaty with that tribe, now you are barred from it. Now you can't help. Although they are Muslims. Although they want your help. Although they, are asking for your help. But because they have not immigrated, why have they stayed back? When they have stayed back, they have not immigrated, they lose the right that they must be protected. Okay, if the tribe has no treaty, actually, then the help can be given, but not if you have a treaty with them. وَإِنْ اسْتَنْصَرُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ فَعَلَيْكُمُ النَّصْرُ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ مِيثَاقٌ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. And whatever you are doing, Allah is seeing it. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. As for those who have rejected the faith, who have suppressed the testimony of their souls, and belied what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was conveying to them. بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. They are friends and protectors to each other. إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ كَبِيرٌ. If you don't do this, there will be much disturbance in the land. What does it mean? If you ignore the treaty and go to help the Muslims of that tribe while you had the treaty with the tribe, it is going to disturb the things. The system has to be kept. If you have made a treaty, you can't help the Muslims over there. You have to do it. Now this ayah, last but one, but this completes the definition of a true mu'min. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آوَوْا وَنَصَرُوا أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ. And those who accepted the faith, who responded positively to the call of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then they immigrated, they left their homes and hearts and the land of their ancestors, وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and they strived in the way of Allah. وَالَّذِينَ آوَوْا وَنَصَرُوا, and those who gave them refuge and they helped them. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. They are the true mu'mins. لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ. For them is the maghfirah, the pardoning, the forgiving, and a very honorable provision in the hereafter. Now you look, refer to the ayah number 2 and 3. Ayah number 2 and 3 of this surah. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا لَهُمْ دَرَجَاتٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ. والذين آمنوا وهاجروا وجاهدوا في سبيل الله والذين آووا ونصروا أولئك هم المؤمنون حقا لهم مغفرة ورزق كريم. And this is to which I was referring as three dimensions of the personality of mu'min. One is the internal, esoteric element. Iman, khashiyah, fear of Allah. Fear of standing before Him on the Day of Judgment. أَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. When Allah is remembered or mentioned, their hearts tremble. And when the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are recited unto them, this increases them in faith. their level of yaqeen and their level of conviction increases. So that is one aspect. The second aspect and the third, they are outside, outward behavior. But one outward behavior is وَيُقِيمُ السَّلَاةَ وَمَا رَزْقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, establishing the prayer. And they are spending. But whatever we have provided them with, they are spending for the cause of Allah, for making the deen of Allah supreme, for spreading the message of Allah. This is one. And the other, obvious external side of the third dimension, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آوَوْا وَنَصَرُوا أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. So these are the three dimensions of the personality of a mu'min. And if you want one ayah embracing all them, that is the ayah number 14 of Surah Al-Hujurat. In ayah number 13 in Surah Al-Hujurat, a distinction is made between Muslim and mu'min. قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم. These Bedouins are claiming that we have come to believe. Tell them, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have not at all come to believe. Don't be mistaken. Only what you can say is that you have come, become Muslims. You have submitted. You have surrendered. And the true faith, true Iman, لما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم, has not as yet entered your hearts. Now with this background, a comprehensive definition of a mu'min comes in the next ayah, ayah number 15 of Surah Al-Hujurat. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. This is the internal. They have the conviction, not only profession, not only saying with the tongue. Then they have no doubt. They believe in Allah and His Messenger. And they have no doubts about it. وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And the second, and they strive hard in the way of Allah with their belongings and lives. So a comprehensive, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. Only such people are true if they claim to be true believers, real believers. Here we find, you know, one part of it in the very beginning, the other part of it at the end. But the beauty, you know, there also in the beginning also, first ayah was something else. يَسَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَنْفَالِ, a legal question. In the same way, the last ayah of this surah is also something relating to a legal point. There was also second and three ayah, third ayah, and here also last but one. Now the last ayah. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْ بَعْدُ وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا مَعَهُمْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مِنْهُمْ. Whosoever now will believe after that. This was the beginning of the Muslim society at Medina, comprising of two parts. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آوَوْا وَنَصَرُوا. Now later on, who are now believing, later on, till the end of this world, this ayah will cover forever. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْ بَعْدُ وَهَاجَرُوا. And now whosoever will come to believe after that, and if they also make hijrah, وَجَاهَدُوا مَعَكُمْ, and if they also strive hard for the cause of Allah with you, فَأُولَٰئِكَ مِنْكُمْ, they will be a part and parcel of your own society. They will also become a part and parcel, they will be from you. But وَأُولُو الْأَرْحَامِ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلَىٰ بِبَعْضٍ, the blood relations will remain nearer to each other. You know, this relation of Iman is not going to cover the law, Islamic law. Inheritance won't go to a brother whom the Prophet declared to be a brother. Of an Ansari, a Muhajir is a brother, but inheritance won't go to him. That is, you know, the legal issue. Yeah, they are brothers, you are brothers, you must love each other more than the real brothers. But the law will take the precedence. And وَأُولُو الْأَرْحَامِ بَعْضُكُمْ أَوْلَىٰ بِبَعْضٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. And this word kitab usually comes in Quran for the legal structure of Islam. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمْ, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمْ, you know, kitaban, حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ الْكِتَابُ أَجَلَهُ. So all these words, you know, in different places, kitab mostly refers to the legal teachings of Quran as regards the legal structure. Ulul arham ba'dhum awla bi ba'dhin. Now these relatives, they are closer to each other. These blood relations, the womb relation of the wombs of the mothers. You are brothers because you were born of the same mother. But you are brothers because you are also Muslim, he is also Muslim. You are a Muhajir and he is an Ansari. But this brothership is something else. That brothership is something else. وَأُولُوا الْأَرْحَامِ أَوْلَىٰ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلَىٰ بِبَعْضٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. Verily Allah knows everything. He is aware of everything. Here this surah ends. Now let me give you, in the few minutes that are left, some basic things about Surah At-Tawbah. Surah At-Tawbah, as I told you in the beginning, when I was giving you the introductory remarks about Surah Al-Anfal, this Surah Al-Mubarakah is the last, at least, of the long Madani Surahs. There are smaller Madani Surahs. For example, we shall find 10 of them, starting from Surah Al-Hadid to Surah Al-Tahrim. There are 10 Surahs, Madani Surahs, but they are small. Two sections, three sections, only one has four sections. The long surahs, Al-Baqarah, Al-Imran, Al-Nisa, Al-Ma'idah, Al-Anfal also, because 10 sections. Then we have Surah An-Nur, there's also some, but you know, 9 sections perhaps. And again, Surah Al-Ahzab. But you know, the last to be revealed among these large Madani surahs is Surah At-Tawbah. But you know the difficulty that most of the translators have faced, and some of the interpreters and the mufassirin of our time, they are mistaken. They don't know that, you know, there is a division of the ayat of this surah regarding the time of the revelation. This surah consists of three parts. Ayat, first 6 ayat, 1 to 6. And then 25 to 37. They were revealed near the end of the 9th year after Hijrah, just before the pilgrimage, when the Prophet ﷺ had sent already people from Medina, 300 of them. They left Medina as a caravan. And Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was made the chief of that caravan. The Prophet himself was not accompanying. He went for the first time and the last time next year, that is the 10th year after Hijrah. So that caravan of Hajj had departed at that time. These ayat 1 to 6 and 25 to 37 were revealed. Then from 7 to 24, they were revealed much earlier, more than a year earlier, before the victory of Badr, and it was in the 8th year after Hijrah, victory of Makkah. In the 8th year after Hijrah. So these two sections, comprising of ayah 7 to 24, they were revealed before the victory of Makkah. The rest of the surah from 38th ayat till the end. This was revealed during the period extending from Rajab to Zi-Qa'dah of Sun 9, year 9 after Hijrah. When, number one, preparation was being made for this battle of and journey of Tabuk. Then the journey towards Tabuk, then the stay at Tabuk, then the coming back from Tabuk to Medina, and some ayat after arrival in Medina. This is a long period, a few months, from Rajab to Zi-Qa'dah. And that is, you know, the time of revelation of ayat number 38 to the end of the surah. So I wanted to give you this analysis only, and tomorrow, inshallah, we shall study the surah At-Tawbah. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم
الله أكبر الله أكبر.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having 4 levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together, we can make a difference.